So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you all for joining us. Again, at this year's Congress, we have seen many changes, from the special mini-symposium session on Thursday to offering more networking opportunities. Our Congress team has worked extremely hard to condense everything in to just 2.5 days. We hope that you've enjoyed the new face of Congress. And for those that are in the room that were part of the planning committee, just let's give them a big round of applause, because again, it was fantastic. And in keeping with this change of format and change of Congress, we will soon be hearing from our very first closing keynote speaker. But first, there's going to be an important message that we're going to play on video here from the Honorable Stephen Fletcher. Mr. Fletcher was first elected to the House of Commons in 2004. Mr. Fletcher is the first individual with quadriplegia to serve in the House of Commons in the cabinet. He is a national leader in health issues, including palliative care and dying with dignity. With the recent Supreme Court ruling, Mr. Fletcher's call to action is timely and important for Canadians and our profession. I had the personal pleasure of meeting Stephen Fletcher in 2004. I was Commodore of our yacht club, and we had successfully secured a bid for the Mobility Cup 2004 Disabled Sail Regatta, which brought in about 30 athletes from across the world. Stephen was one of two quadriplegic competitors, racers. What just struck me about Stephen was that if you've been to Manitoba in September, our weather can be kind of nasty, and so for 4 days, these disabled sail athletes, which all had varying degrees of disability, sailed some pretty treacherous waters. It was quite windy and cold, and Stephen was just phenomenal in his ability to navigate the waters, and I thought that if this man can navigate Manitoba waters, he could probably navigate the treacherous waters of politics, and so I think he's done that quite well. Just a little kind of a side note, when the video gets rolling here shortly, just due to Mr. Fletcher's condition with his breathing, you'll certainly hear some pauses, and so the video may seem a little bit slow, but it's the power of the message that I'm sure will inspire you. So, Mr. Fletcher.
Hello, my name is Stephen Fletcher, Member of Parliament for Charleswood, St. James, Assiniboia, Headingley. I am pleased to have the opportunity to address the Canadian Physiotherapy Association. I do regret that I am unable to be in Halifax in person. Unfortunately, house business keeps me away. But I know the important role physiotherapists play in the medical system, and I wanted to at least have the opportunity to share with you some thoughts on how physiotherapists can continue to improve the quality of life of Canadians and also help us as government MPs navigate through the Supreme Court ruling on physician-assisted death. Let me share with you a little bit about my background. I was 23, had a great career lined up in the mining industry, just graduated from engineering, and I hit a moose with my car. And the moose went through the windshield, back seat, the car went into the ditch, and the moose flew over me again. And of course, this was in northern Manitoba in 1996, at a time before cell phones. So people had to drive an hour to Wyatt to be found. Then it was an hour to the nearest town. Then they had to drive the ambulance up and then back to the city. So it was many hours before I was seen. And once I was, I was told I was going to be paralyzed from the neck down. And if I were to live, if I'd likely be in an institution for the rest of my life. This is not good news for a 23-year-old or anyone. So, as time went on, as in 24 hours from the accident, my lungs collapsed and I was intubated and was suctioned minute by minute, hour by hour, day after day for months. And then they put in a trach and the same thing. And it was awful. I would not wish it on anyone. But that's what happens to some people with ALS. They end up where I started off, drowning in their own phlegm. Now, I was going to get better. Some cases, like Sue Rodriguez, it just gets worse. It is based on this experience that I introduced legislation a couple years ago to allow for physician-assisted death under certain circumstances and with all the caveats one would hope would exist to ensure integrity in the process and to protect the vulnerable. The Supreme Court this past February actually passed a ruling very similar to my legislation and has, in a certain framework, allowed for physician-assisted death. And in this framework, the Supreme Court has outlined the conditions on which someone could find or could apply to have the procedure. They have to be a Canadian citizen, a competent adult, over 18, and suffering from excruciating pain, terminal illness, or disability. This is where I think physiotherapists can come in big time. In regard to the issue of quality of life of the individual, I'd like to share with you a story of a physiotherapist who worked at Health Sciences Center, who I will forever be grateful to. Her name was, or is, Denny Elliott, and actually from Ireland, as I recall. In the months after my accident, she would come in, you know, in the towards nighttime, like, and pummel me, and on the back, and on the front, to help dislodge that phlegm. And there was a lot of phlegm. I'm convinced that without her intervention, I would not have recovered, certainly not as quickly, and maybe not at all. She did this work often on her own time and away from her family. She believed in me, which helped me believe in me. The fact that she was doing this not because it was her job, but because she thought it was the right thing to do. And there was a fellow human in distress. Denny, I'm sure, is now long retired, but she, as an individual by the bedside, helped improve the quality of my life to the point where I could breathe and start taking the next stages in my rehabilitation. But you have to be able to breathe to go on. So, clinically, physiotherapists have a huge role to play. And we can think of countless scenarios where a physiotherapist can improve through physiotherapy or even just attitude, improve the quality of life of individuals. Now, the other way the physiotherapy community can help is the government of Canada has provided 1 year to respond to the physician-assisted death decision. And the response could come in a variety of ways. But I think it's imperative that organizations like the Canadian Physiotherapy Association have their say, have your say in what you believe legislation should encompass. Now, it could be, when all is said and done, there'll be no legislation and it'll be up to the provinces. Or there could be legislation like my private member's bill that demands for checks and balances, that only a physician be able to conduct the procedure, that there's no institutional pressure for someone to pass on or family pressure, that these decisions are made by competent adults without fear or favor. That's a big task. And we need people who care and are involved, provide the companionship, the knowledge base, and the power to make sure that we make the right decision as Canadians. Because let me be clear about this. That Supreme Court decision will affect, one way or another, every Canadian that is alive, every Canadian that will ever be, and probably be the framework for physician-assisted death throughout the developed world. The stakes are high. Let's get it right. And as we move forward, let's do so with compassion, empathy, respect, understanding, and mercy. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
What an incredible message and so very compelling. Physiotherapy saves lives. And just his recognition of what our profession offers to working with palliative care individuals and assisting in the quality of life of these individuals. And I think more importantly that Stephen's seeking our voice and support in whatever shape that may take, but we're in his thought process, and if it's in his thought process, we know it's going to be in front of other political bodies as well. So, and if you ever get a chance to meet Stephen in person, he's an incredibly dynamic man. I imagine going back to the sailing regatta, there was a number of his competitors wished that his physio wasn't quite as good as she was, because Stephen controlled his, he skippered his own boat, and it was all done through sip and puff. So he sip and puffed the sails in and out. So he had a, his lung dynamics are, was that much better than a number out there. So he was very competitive. So again, just having physiotherapy in his thought process and at this higher level of discussion is quite, quite incredible. So if you ever get a chance to meet him, please do. So. Now, this is really exciting. Get to introduce the first closing keynote speaker. Rachel Lowe is a founding director of Physiopedia, a physiotherapist from the UK. She's worked in various clinical settings prior to taking a self-directed learning path to become an unlikely physiotechie. Building on her knowledge of web-based learning, she now project manages Physiopedia, one of the largest open online physiotherapy education companies in the world. Drawing from personal experience of adversity, opportunity, and inspiration, Rachel tells us of the Physiopedia story and how you can pursue your big dreams by starting small today. Please welcome Rachel Lowe.
Thank you, Doug. Hello, everyone. Wow, how am I going to follow that? So, well, I've told this Physiopedia story many times, but I've never told the full story. So I've been saving that for the brave people that invite me to do my first keynote. When I received the invitation to do this talk, I was honored and delighted and accepted. I didn't tell them that I hadn't done a live presentation for 4 years. So bear with me. Let's see how this goes. So truly, it's a great honor for me to tell you this story. It's a story about injury and about illness and injury, about adversity and opportunity, about having fun and making a difference. It's about the power of dreaming big and working hard to make that dream a reality. Now, not a lot of people know this, but about 23 years ago, I was diagnosed with ME, chronic fatigue syndrome. Prior to this, I'd been a very active and a very ambitious young lady. I'd just cycled all around England. I'd just returned from an expedition to Mongolia. I was in my first year of my physiotherapy degree, and I was having fun. I was learning to windsurf. I was enjoying my life, my new social life, away from my parents. So it was devastating to go back home and spend 6 months in bed. Those 2 years that I spent at home were life-changing. The lack of understanding of ME at the time meant that I had no medical support at all, to the point that my doctors wrote me off as if I was someone that was putting it all on. I lost all of my energy. I had a headache, and boy, did I have a headache for a long time. I couldn't read, I couldn't write, I couldn't concentrate at all. I couldn't socialize. I lost all of my muscle tone and quite a lot of my confidence. So I'm sure that you've all got a really good picture of this challenging patient in your heads. But skip forward 10 years. I've graduated from university. I'm married to Tony, who's down here in the audience. I'm running 3 small private clinics. I'm on a master's program, and I'm on an adventure racing team. So I've done quite well, and I'm living my life to the max again. But I did have another skill, and that was I knew how to take responsibility for my own health. And I knew that at this point in time, I was on a downward spiral of energy consumption again, and I knew that I had to stop. And so I gave it all up again, except for the marriage, of course. So we moved to the south coast of England. We became wardens on a caravan site, and I think you might know this better, sorry, as a trailer park. Now, this was quite a lot of fun. We were outside all the time, every day. We did a lot of manual work. We lived by the beach. My 95-year-old grandfather used to come and visit us. He was in a wheelchair following a stroke, and he'd come down for lunch to have some, from his nursing home, to have some fish pie. And it was him that so fondly named our rustic accommodation the shack. Now, living in a shack, being a gardener and a cleaner and a host is fun, but it didn't challenge my brain. So that's when I started to play on the computer. I was completely, like any physio, I was completely useless on the computer at that time. I didn't have a clue what I was doing, but I was really lucky because I had my in-house techie in Tony, who was busy building his e-learning business. Can I ask you a quick question? Is etched on his brain and echoes around the office today still. So the first website that I built was PhysioSpot, which is still alive today. I wanted a way to keep up to date with my CPD. I always thought that I'd go back to clinical practice. I thought I'd be taking just 6 months off just to get my energy back. And so I started blogging. So I just started writing up what I was learning from the articles that I was reading and learning to build a website and openly sharing this knowledge with everyone. And this was, it was a great way to openly share learning. And this is at the forefront of all, it's at the core of all that I do today. And it was also through this openness that I met Eugene Barsky, who some of you may know. He was at the time the physiotherapy librarian at the University of British Columbia. And he was also just getting into social media. It was all very new. And his positive communications at the time were a real confidence boost. It was the only other person in the profession that was there with me. So next on the agenda, we moved into e-learning work. We got some work with a university in the UK to change some of their master's modules into online modules. We worked with one of the professional organizations to turn some of their conference resources into online resources in a website. And we were proud of what we developed, and this was at the forefront of e-learning at the time, and it was probably some of the first online learning for the physiotherapy profession, at least in the UK. So there we were in the shack, Tony and I, I was a clinician, Tony's an educator, and we were both self-taught techies. So in 2007, Tony dragged me, not quite kicking and screaming, to an e-learning conference. Wrong way. It was eye-opening. It was completely eye-opening. I was surrounded by nerds on laptops. And I don't exaggerate when I tell you that this is what it looked like. I didn't have a clue what was going on at that conference. I didn't understand a thing. Most of it went straight over the top of my head. So I was at a few presentations, but there was one sort of type of presentation that really fascinated me, and that was the presentations on wikis. I came away from that conference thinking, I want a wiki. Wouldn't it be great to have Wikipedia for physiotherapy? Wouldn't it be great to have this huge online resource that contained the whole sum of physiotherapy knowledge, a constantly updating online textbook. So installing the MediaWiki software, that's the same software that Wikipedia runs on. It was quite beyond me at the time, so I needed to seek the help of my in-house techie. I'd say to him, just imagine if we have thousands of physios all editing our Physiopedia and how amazing that's going to be. And he'd simply look at me, he was busy earning money for us at the time, he'd look at me and say, it's not going to happen. But I wanted this wiki, so I was persuasive. So I would say to him, you know, it's going to be great. There's going to be, we're going to build this thing. It's going to be, everyone's going to get involved. So I would persist and I would say, can I have a wiki? No. Can I have a wiki? No. Please, can I have a wiki? No. But I did persist, and 6 months later, he was prepared to do anything to shut me up, so I got my wiki. So it's funny because there's this video that some of you may have seen online, and it's of a guy dancing. I'm not going to play the video, this is just a screenshot, and I encourage you to look this video up at another time. But there's this video, this guy is at a summer festival, there's music playing, and he's dancing on his own, all on his own, a bit weirdly, and everyone's looking at him, everyone's laughing, everyone's thinking he's a bit weird, and then some other people go over and join him. And so they join him and they dance with him, and then some more people and some more people. And he is described as a lone nut that starts a movement. And this presentation is used to demonstrate leadership. And the funny thing is that I got sent that video several times, clearly demonstrating that I was a lone nut. So there I was, in the shack, creating structure and content for Physiopedia, for my wiki. I was adding page after page, and some with content, but most of the time I was just adding a template just to make it look like the wiki had content. And I think I created over 200 pages in the wiki initially. And then in March 2009, out of the blue, I was contacted by Aileen Barrett, who was an educator at the Royal College of Surgeons in Ireland, and she had overheard me talking to David Baxter, who's from New Zealand, about Physiopedia, and she wanted to run an educational project with her students. And so this is an elective module, and she had two groups of students, and they created a page each in Physiopedia. This was brilliant. I was contacted out of the blue. We ran this project. They created two pages. They were good. One of the pages, the auscultation page, is still one of the most popular pages on the site today. So then word gets out, not by social media, because there's no social media at that time. So it gets out slowly. Word gets around, and we see some other people participating and content being written. So there's other people starting to write the content for us. So this is great. I've got through the first barrier. The site begins to build momentum and more people, and it starts being built by the community. And so only 6 years later, where we are now, we've run over 30 of these educational projects, content building projects, and we've got nearly 2,000 articles on the site. And I just want to let you know that we officially ran educational projects before Wikipedia. So as we've gone on this journey, building the roadmap as we go, I've learned a lot about the global profession. And a lot of people have been involved, and they've been a great source of inspiration and motivation along the way. And I just want to introduce you to a few of those people and the stories that come with them. So meet Tyler Schultz. Tyler, at the time, was a physical therapy student in Georgia in the United States. And he'd heard about Physiopedia because one of his lecturers had told him about it, because we'd been passing some ideas past him, Eric Robertson. And Tyler started using Physiopedia independently on his own, and he taught us how useful it can be for an individual to use Physiopedia as a resource and a learning tool. And what he did, he was really interesting, because obviously there weren't many pages at the time, and so he started creating pages as his revision notes, and he went back to them at the time of his exams. Amazingly, Tyler only dropped out of the top 10 contributors a few weeks ago. So really impressive, quite a lot of work at the beginning. So I'm always impressed with the people that work in Physiopedia in their second language. And these days I'm hearing more and more about training courses overseas that are incorporating English into their training programs, like in Brazil and Mongolia, simply because if they don't know English, they won't be able to access the literature. So when Professor Peter Vaes came to me, he wanted to run an educational project with his students. And Peter Vaes is from the University of Brussels in Belgium. So they were going to work in their second language. So Peter put an awful lot of faith in us in the early days. And his students, they took on 100 pages, they created 100 pages in Physiopedia, and they continue today, 5 years later, to review and update those pages on an annual basis. And so by putting so much faith in us in the beginning, Peter gave me a reason, gave us a reason to really make this project work, because we now had all this student work that we needed to keep alive. He also gave me the confidence to encourage people to work in Physiopedia in their second language, which is a challenge. So we've learned quite a lot from these educational projects, and we've run a few over the years, but one of the hardest working people I know that's run projects is Elaine Lonneman. Elaine is amazing. She works really hard. She's the one on the right, by the way. She, not only does she have four teenage boys, she has alpacas, goats, bees, dogs, who knows what else. She's secretary of AEOMT. She is a distance tutor at the University of Augusta in Florida. She's associate professor at Bellarmine University in Kentucky. And she's run 5 Physiopedia projects, 2 of which continue today. But the important thing about Elaine's project is what we learned from them. And we learned that students really enjoy working in Physiopedia. They love contributing to a professional resource. They like to see that their work is going to be used by the community in years to come. And we also learned that as soon as you move a paper-based assignment into an online assignment, their grades improve immediately. So it's a win-win. We get content. They get good grades for their students. But it's not just students working in Physiopedia. We have professional organizations also, and clinical situations. So just a few examples. The Physiotherapy Pain Association in the UK is running a CPD project for their members, where they create or update a page and they get a CPD certificate for it. Agile is the older people section in the UK, and IPTOP, the international section, are working to create the older people section and keep it updated. There's a trauma department at St. George's Hospital Trust in London who create the trauma section. So there's lots of these projects going on. Like I said, we've done over 30 so far. So in Physiopedia, we curate, analyze, and openly publish information and evidence that is available and as a digestible source of clinically relevant information, a knowledge translation tool. This idea of being a knowledge translation tool has been reinforced by 2 of your very good colleagues. Anita Gross, who unfortunately isn't here this afternoon, and her team at McMaster University, they gave us one of their treatment toolkits, clinical treatment toolkits, and it's the Manual Therapy and Exercise for Neck Pain Clinical Treatment Toolkit. And they gave us that to publish openly in Physiopedia just so that they could reach the masses. And also Alison Hones is the physiotherapy knowledge broker in British Columbia, and I'm sure some of you know these people, and they've given us around 5 toolkits that we've published openly in Physiopedia with the sole aim of just getting them out to the masses so that the knowledge is easily translated. And let's not forget these people. These are our amazing volunteers. We have a volunteer program. They do a short course before they qualify to work for us or help us out. I've had some feedback recently from one of the volunteers that's just completed the course, and they said, "I have found that the experience of doing this course has reinvigorated my passion for ensuring clinical excellence." Wow, that was amazing to receive that feedback. You know who you all are, you are amazing, you are our greatest supporters, you keep us going, and we really couldn't do it without you. You've totally turbocharged the Physiopedia project. And if we can have that slide back up, some of you are CPA members. On the bottom left is Laura. Laura's been with us for a few years. She's our media manager, and she's down here in the audience. She's giving a big wave. And then on the bottom right is Evan Thomas, who as well, unfortunately, couldn't be here today. So my first followers gave me reason and confidence to carry on dancing. I'm no longer that lone nut. And that's the end of that video. So I'm just a caretaker for Physiopedia. It's not mine, it's yours. It's a non-profit project and it's free for you to use. There's no roadmap, it's simply the ideas and contributions of many that have given me something to build and look after for the profession. And just not forgetting, don't forget that a small group of people can make huge change. So, in January 2012, we moved to Chamonix in France. The sole aim was to become awesome at skiing, so what better place than the adventure capital of Europe, right? 4 days later, we're skiing back home on the last run of the day, we're off-piste, it's amazing, and I'm making a tired duff turn. And I couldn't be bothered, so I just gave in to the fall. I'm like, oh, I'm just gonna fall over and sit, have a rest and sit down. And I swear that at that moment in time, time slowed down, because as I fell, I heard two enormous audible rips. I sat there in the snow, you know what's coming. I sat there in the snow with my ruptured ACL, my ruptured MCL, and my tibial fractures. I waved at Tony at the bottom of the slope, who waved back at me. It was a surprisingly calm moment. What now, I thought, as I sat there with 12 months of rehab stretching out ahead of me. Okay, let's turn this into a positive. I'm gonna work really hard on Physiopedia and see what we can do. And sadly, I did sit there thinking that. And it's funny now, because when you look at the visitor statistics of Physiopedia, in January 2012, they started rising, and the engagement in the project was obvious from that time forward. Fortunately for Physiopedia, not so fortunately for me, my knee injury was rather complex, and it took 3 years for me to rehab. So as a target, Tony and I set ourselves until WCPT Congress this year, 2015, to make a valuable and sustainable resource for our profession. So, in early 2013, we were contacted by Michael Rowe, who's a lecturer at the University of Western Cape in South Africa. Michael was running, this is Tony and Michael in Singapore recently. Michael is the one on your right. Michael runs a professional ethics course with his students at the university, and he wanted to run that course online, openly, and to invite other people to join in. So Michael had recently finished a PhD where he'd developed a set of learning principles. He designed a set of learning principles to design learning spaces. So what better person than to run this project than Michael? So we said yes. And MOOCs, massive open online courses, they were really interesting at the time, really new at the time, and we were really interested to see if we could run one in Physiopedia and what would happen. So we said yes. We took the project forward. We had 60 of Michael's students on the course and 68 of our Physiopedia students from all over the world, and it was a very interesting course. It went very well. We met a lot of nice people, and there were some interesting stories from that course. There were people from all races, all religions, and all over the world. We talked about discrimination, euthanasia, and torture, among other things. We even had a conversation about whether physiotherapy could be considered a form of torture. On this course, we met Sheikh Abdul Qadir. Sheikh introduced himself to us as he was a physiotherapy student, but he didn't want to be a physio, he wanted to be a doctor. Okay? With some direction, he completed the course, and he is one of our most enthusiastic volunteers today, and he's recently been the project assistant on the amputee course that we're running. After that, and now it feels like he's proud to be a physio, so it's been an interesting journey with Sheikh. We also met Wendy on the professional ethics course. Wendy's an experienced clinician from the UK, and she specializes in facial palsy. And she has super amounts of energy, which I'm jealous of. I remember meeting her at CSP Congress, and we went for coffee and cake, and I came away from that coffee thinking, where does she get all that energy? And maybe I should eat some more cake. But see, being of a slightly older and less techie generation, Wendy was really concerned about the personal portfolio, the learning portfolio that everyone had in this professional ethics course, because it was a blog online. And that really wasn't helped when she told her son she was going to start blogging. He laughed at her. But today, she persevered, and she is a confident Physiopedia editor. She works on all the older people projects that we run. She is the manager of our neurology section, and she has a little facial palsy expert section in Physiopedia, which she uses in her teaching to her patients and to her colleagues. So through running this course with Michael, we ended up with a great little model for scaling up and running other courses. So I called Lisa. Lisa Harvey is an associate professor at the University of Sydney, and I met Lisa on a technology panel in Amsterdam at WCPT Congress in Amsterdam in 2011. Now, Lisa had told us that she's a spinal cord injury expert, and she told us that she was troubled by the poor management that some individuals with spinal cord injury were getting around the world. And so she'd gone on a one-woman mission to change that. And so she was traveling around all over the world teaching 10 people at a time. So the idea of putting her online resources, which she had just built, she had some online content, of taking that and putting it into an open online course in Physiopedia was really attractive to her. It's funny because I asked her in an interview a couple of years later, at the time of the course, I said, why did you decide to do that online? I couldn't remember why we'd started it. Why did you decide to do that online open course with us on managing spinal cord injury patients? And she simply said, because you persuaded me to, Rachel. And it's funny because at the time it was such an intense experience and so very stressful. But that course as well was totally mind-blowing. We had over 4,000 registrants on that course. So 4,000 physiotherapists registered to take this course. And it was accredited by the WCPT. The interactions that we saw in this course were mind-blowing. The peer-to-peer learning interactions in the discussion forum, just a joy to read and watch. It was clinically relevant, and there was a direct impact on clinical practice that we saw, and we even saw some lives potentially being saved. Sanet, whose surname I can't remember, from South Africa, told us that she, after the course, she was able to educate doctors in her region on the dangers of mobilizing patients with DVTs. And someone from the Philippines told us that they had a spinal cord injury patient in this week and they knew what to do with them. It was great. And we also had groups of students and their tutors taking the course together. Oh, sorry, this is Lisa. I missed Lisa. So here's Lisa. And these are the students that earned their certificates together. So this whole course, it really opened our eyes to the global reach that Physiopedia had and the possibilities for future global networking and learning. It was clear that this could be a great complement to existing physiotherapy education. So currently, we're running our third open online course. It's on managing the individual with limb loss, amputees, and we're running it in collaboration with the International Committee of the Red Cross. It's a 6-week course. We have over 7,500 registered participants on that course, and they are starting week 4 on Monday, and 577 of them are Canadians. So I've met one person this week who's on the course. Is anyone else on the course? Yay! So you can all talk to these people about how the course is going. And I really hope you're all enjoying it. So it's June 2015. We became the first non-profit partner of WCPT in 2013. And the recent WCPT Congress was our deadline. At that Congress, we were completely blown away by the positive vibes that we had coming to us on our exhibition stand. It was amazing. We had people coming up to find us to specifically say thank you. We even had one person come up to find us who said, thank you, you saved my degree, which is a little bit concerning. And at this conference this week, I met Megan Benink on Friday at the reception. And when we were introduced to her, she said, "Oh, I love Physiopedia. It's my favorite website." So Megan, thank you. Give us a wave. And she's over there, and there's a big blue hand for her to give you a wave over here. But so thank you, Megan. So at any given one time, there are around 120 to 150 people using Physiopedia. I keep missing my slides, I'm sorry. This is at the Congress. Any given one time, 120 to 150 people using Physiopedia. We've been visited by every single country in the world except Western Sahara. So if you're off to Western Sahara anytime soon, you know what to do. In the last month alone, we've had over 900,000 visits. So we've not quite reached that 1 million mark that I was really hoping for this presentation, hence the title of my presentation, but we aim to be there soon. We've gone from one person, me, to nearly 1 million visits every month. And so I think we're really on the verge of realizing that this is this one big idea for a free open resource that contains the sum of physiotherapy knowledge is, you know, I think we've realized that idea. So we, Tony and I, consider Physiopedia to be a success. It still hasn't reached its potential, but we're aiming to realize that potential. What hasn't been a success is my ability to ski. There's a lot of potential, and I'm aiming to realize that potential. I did get a little bit better at ice climbing. So, what does the future have in store for Physiopedia? Well, we want to run more of these courses. They're amazing. So we'd like to run more. We'd like to reach all corners of the world and do what we can for physiotherapy education. We want to involve more people in content building and in updating and reviewing the content that is already existing in Physiopedia. And we want to make a difference. But mainly, it's directed by you, our users. We do what you ask us to do. We take it where you want it to go. And in some respects, we're going to be directed by where healthcare and technology developments take us. So because of that, I'm always wondering what's around the corner for our profession. We're going to become more involved in preventing ill health. We will be threatened by other professions encroaching upon our domain as we encroach upon theirs. And we'll be dictated to by healthcare insurers, and we'll have to respond. But I don't think this is in the future. I think this is now. I think we're a really traditional profession. I think we're reactive and slow to change. This has been evidenced recently by the slow embrace of social media by our profession. And I think I've seen that because I started on Twitter in 2007, before it was even called social media. And what I saw then at that e-learning conference around that time is what I'm seeing now in physiotherapy. And it's taken us 7 or 8 years to get to that position. And it just demonstrates how that we are quite slow to embrace change. And you know, the world is changing and we need to change with it, because if we don't, there are big healthcare changes ahead, and I think we're ripe for disruption. So Thomas Frey is a futurist, and I don't think he could have put it better than this by saying, "Humanity will change more in the next 20 years than in all of human history." So let's consider the future quickly. What if ill health becomes normal? Non-communicable diseases are on the rise. They're the leading cause of death worldwide, and they're on the rise. More than 38 million people die of non-communicable diseases every year. That's 63% of global deaths, and 40% of those are premature. And you all have a 20% chance of dying prematurely from a non-communicable disease. The predictions for the enormity and the human and financial burden of chronic disease is staggering. The WHO predicts that in 2030, 55 million people will die each year from a preventable non-communicable disease. In the developed world, that's looking at 89% of all deaths. So what if we continue to lose this battle? Imagine a world where everyone has an NCD. Imagine a world where everyone has a disability from a non-communicable disease. Imagine a world where our children don't know what it's like to be healthy. This isn't beyond the realms of possibility. So on the world stage, the focus is shifting from communicable diseases, where we've done an amazing job, to non-communicable diseases. The World Health Organization has an agenda with the Global NCD Action Plan. And many people are considering that how to fit in with the post-2015 development goals. And we can contribute. There's going to have to be a paradigm shift in our profession, when it's not going to be just about managing conditions and treating conditions, but moving into preventing this huge global threat. So we need to step up. But conversely, the progression in technological development is unrelenting and staggering, and it may lead to a world where there is no ill health. So Tricia Parsons wasn't far wrong yesterday in the debate when she started talking about robots. It is predicted that by 2025, a single computer will have the processing power of all the human brains on the planet. And that computer is going to fit into your pocket. So this gives rise to conversations about artificial intelligence and the rise of the machine, and how healthcare professionals may be replaced by machines. So meet IBM's Watson. He's the one in the middle. Watson is a supercomputer that can learn. He can observe, interpret, and analyze over 30,000 documents a day. He is the computer that famously went on Jeopardy and beat these two previous reigning champions. Now Watson's in an oncology institute in the United States somewhere, and he is learning how to diagnose and make treatment recommendations for cancer patients. So people are talking about machines taking the place of doctors, doing the same work with better results for less money. So just how far can this automation of medicine go? Well, have you heard about the XPRIZE? The founder of the XPRIZE, Peter Diamandis, he's an inspiration for us all to think big. He wanted to go to space, so he trained to be an astronaut. And when he realized that he was never going to make it as an astronaut, he decided to make a competition to build him, for someone else to build him a spaceship to take him to space. He funded that with a $10 million prize, and that competition was won within 8 years, and he was able to go to space. So since then, there have been many other X Prizes, and one of the current X Prizes is the Qualcomm Tricorder X Prize. And my in-house techie assures me that, yes, this is to build the tricorder from Star Trek. So this is a device. It fits in the palm of your hand, and it will monitor and diagnose your health conditions. It's a device that will fit in your pocket, and it'll be as effective as a team of specialists. So the end result of this is going to give individuals far greater choice of when and where and how they have their health delivery. Healthcare. And it's not going to take 8 years this time, and it is going to happen. So it just makes me wonder what happens if healthcare goes completely online. What if we have virtual consultations with Watson and with our tricorder? What does this mean for us as a profession? So who's heard of nanobots? Nanobots are small artificial organic devices that travel the body seeking out and removing disease even before it presents itself. There are some people training bacteria to seek out cancer even before we know it's there and get rid of it. And yes, I said training bacteria. So imagine these nanobots, they may be able to find inflammation, remove inflammation, remove any disease, remove scar tissue, even before it develops or we know it's there. And if they can't do that, what they're going to be able to do is synthesize medications and deliver it at a site of need and at a point of need and a time of need without us having to think about it. So just imagine if ultimately there's no ill health. What does this mean for us? Everyone's healthy. As opposed to us all dying prematurely from NCDs, there's no ill health. One disruptive medical technology that's happening now that I'm sure everyone's aware of is quantitative health and self-healthcare monitoring. And patients are going to start to bring you their personal healthcare data, and I'm sure some of them already are, that they've recorded with their watch or their iPhone, any phone. And this, they're going to be able to tell you how much exercise they did, what exercises they did, how much sleep they had, their blood pressure, their heart rate, their glucose levels, everything. It's going to get really tedious. But we're going to need to use this data. Healthcare insurers are going to use this data to allow or deny treatments. Healthcare insurers are going to use this data to analyze your performance. Healthcare is going to be more data-driven about wellness instead of sick care. So how are we going to use this data as a profession to improve our patient outcomes? So, I mean, I've focused on NCDs and technology because that's where my interest lies, and I don't deny that there are many other challenges that our profession is going to face. There are going to be major challenges ahead for our profession. We all need to think about the future. We need to be proactive instead of trundling along in the present, being reactive, and that is meant to be slightly provocative. We need a business plan in place for all these scenarios, and we need to have our position and our role in place. What we really need to do is thrive in the face of change. You know, we could be the profession that really responds to the challenges of NCDs. We could be the profession that thrives in the developments of technology. So, ill health and injury have presented two personal adversities in my life. But they've both presented me with great opportunity. I've learned to take responsibility for my own health, and I've learned to make opportunity out of adversity. I've also learned that it takes really hard work and selfless, unlimited perseverance to make something happen. Without these lessons, I'm quite sure that today I wouldn't be as healthy as I am, and also physiopedia wouldn't exist. So I'm going to bring my remarks to a close now and just say, what does all of this mean for you? What challenges am I asking you for? Well, I want to encourage you to nurture your ideas, however big or small. We all have ideas and we all have the ability to make them happen. It doesn't have to be about business plans, about fundraising, venture capitalism, all of that kind of stuff. You just have to believe in your idea, have faith, start small and start today. You do have the power to make a big difference. So this big idea to build the free online knowledge resource, it just didn't seem possible at the time, but look where we are today. So what's your big idea? What ideas have you had at this conference? What would you do if someone gave you £1 million? What is the Physiotherapy X Prize? And in the words of Peter Diamandis again, this isn't about egos, and I just want to shift your aspirations to think big. But having big ideas isn't for everyone, but all big ideas need supporters. So be a follower and help other people with their big ideas, and what better place to start than by supporting Stephen Fletcher? So you are our profession. And to repeat Scott Jones, don't be afraid, be brave. Think big, think global, and be inspiring. Or you could hang out with a lone nut. Thank you.
Wow. I've had great opportunity to listen to a lot of keynote speakers over time, but holy, that was just great. You know, many folks speak of innovating, many attempt to innovate, but Rachel, you're living innovation, and the global impact that you're having is just phenomenal. So thank you. One more time for Rachel. Just like a wow again. That's great. It is my great pleasure to introduce and invite to the stage your new CPA president, Dr. Linda Woodhouse.
Thanks, Doug. Well, I get the terrible pleasure of closing the ceremonies as we go through, and it's just been an amazing Congress. As we close off and look forward to Congress 2016, they asked if I'd give a few thoughts, and so the first thing I wanted to do is thank people. And I think this has been one of the best-run conferences I think I've ever been at, and certainly with very large numbers. So I wanted to thank Sea to Sky in particular, to all the CPA staff who participated in really making this an incredible event, and most importantly, the people that you see in the blue shirts, the students and volunteers who came forward. And I don't know if you had a chance to talk to some of them. I certainly did, and they're just amazing people. So please join me in thanking all of those. So my impressions, well, it was a really, really well-attended Congress, and I want to hearken back to what our CEO said the other day, and that was, you know, I remember, and I thought it was just a few years ago that I attended Congress, and I felt pretty young then. People looking around, which is the good news, are getting younger and younger. So I think we're drawing out those individuals. And I think the challenge for us is that you always have to create a win-win-win situation. People come to see what you're about. They'll come once and maybe twice. But beyond that, unless they're getting something out of Congress, unless they're getting something out of their CPA membership, they won't stay around very long. So that's something we're going to strive to really embrace and want your feedback over this Congress period to make sure that we can hit the mark and get even more people out next year. Some of the things that I learned as we went through the last few days, and I have to say that I would like to take the few days and really run it over a week, because to be perfectly honest, there was so much going on and so much richness of content, conversations, an opportunity to meet new friends, new colleagues, to reunite with old colleagues and old friends. Many of whom I haven't even had a chance to see, because I think if we took that 3 days and broadened it to a week, we might get to many more events that were extremely, extremely valuable. There were a lot of powerful messages from nanobots, I think, to humans and what we're capable of doing. And the messages I take away are really the power of one. And one individual, one thought, one movement to move forward really is an amazing thing that can happen. Never miss the opportunity to take a good crisis and make it an opportunity. And I think that's where we're at now as a profession. I'd also like to say thank you to Nova Scotia, because I think we've experienced true Eastern hospitality at the finest, with one caveat. I'm going away horribly disappointed, because when I came here, I expected to walk out understanding where the term blue nose really came from. And I'm going away having more explanations for that term that I came with. So thank you very much to Nova Scotia for hosting us. I also want to say a special thanks to Dr. Emma Stokes, who came from Ireland, and I keep hearing that Irish theme all the way through. Not only for attending this week, she came to address our board and have fruitful conversations with us. I've seen her in just about every venue that I've been in, and also personally because she took me aside and gave me a one-on-one lesson on how to tweet. So I'm going to start tweeting lots of messages out, and I would encourage everybody else to do the same. And she's an amazing mentor. So thank you very much, Emma. And I just want to take another moment of your time to say a little bit about the sessions I attended. I think the restructuring was extremely well done, and we need your feedback on that, so I'd encourage you to fill out the surveys. But I wanted to comment on a couple of areas, and one of them was the TED Talks. I don't like crying in public, so after we got over Alice Aiken's talk and everybody stopped crying, we moved on to the auditor's desk, which is also known as the Dragon's Den. And for those of you who weren't there, the winner was Stephanie Nixon. And that project is related... That project is related to HIV in the sub-Sahara Africa. But there was a more important message. She walked into that room to give a pitch to walk away with $2,000. And before she walked out of the room, there were so many additional people that threw in extra funding that it was well over $9,000 that she walked away with, either from there or partnership funding. So Stephanie, expect a call to join the finance committee. And without further ado, I'd like to invite to come up on stage with me Sahara Singh, who's the Congress 2016 committee representative that's going to tell you why you should join us in Victoria, BC next year for Congress. And I think they're going to unveil the new logo. And before she speaks, I'm going to launch one challenge. You are only allowed to go back home, find one person that hasn't been to Congress before, only one, and invite them and make sure they join us next year. So just one other person is allowed to attend.
So Halifax is going to be pretty hard to beat, but in Victoria we're going to try. So I thought I'd just give you the top 10 reasons why you should visit Victoria next year for Congress. An ode to the recently retired Dave Letterman. So number 10, getting there is half the fun. It's 35 minutes from downtown Vancouver by ferry, and dolphin and whale sightings are common in the spring and summer. Number 9, you can do a floating pub crawl. You can take a pickle boat between local drinking stops. Number 8, Butchart Gardens, which you may have heard about. It's a world-renowned garden, particularly spectacular in the spring. Number 17, well, there's lots of reasons, but number seven, my personal favorite, Victoria is the cycling capital of Canada. Number 6, tea time in more ways than one. No trip to the capital city would be complete without a spot of high tea. And there's also 18 golf courses in Victoria. And if it's a mild winter, you can play all year round. Number 5, Chinatown. Victoria's Chinatown is actually the oldest in Canada, and you can't miss Fantan Alley, which is the narrowest street in all of Canada. Number 4, the Inner Harbor, including the legislative buildings at night lit up with over 3,000 lights. Number 3, a personal favorite, it will make you feel young, because more than 18% of the population of Victoria is over 65. Number 2, Victoria's in the rain shadow of the Olympic Mountains, so unlike where I live in Vancouver, it gets very little rain every year and about over 2,000 hours of sunshine. And the number one reason to visit Victoria is simply to visit us, because I think we're pretty cool people in BC. And we're going to show just a short video that will highlight some of the things I've talked about.
that's the new Congress logo. So we've just had an incredible time and experience with lots of highlights and memories. And I just want to remind you that when you get an email from CPA asking you for feedback, it's not like those college emails that you kind of want to delete or put aside and read later. Read it, open it up, and please, please give us feedback, because we can only move forward from here and make Congress better if we do get the feedback. Thanks to each and every one of you who have attended today. And also a reminder that if you want to go out on the boat for this evening's activity for Local Flavor Night, please get there for the kitchen party very early. There's limited space, as you know, on the cruise. We will have the auction back on land. Go early if you're going on the cruise. You can go early and stay on land and have a drink instead in the dry land reception. And it's sure to be a great time tonight. So I invite you to watch photos from the past few days to still create those lasting memories. And here are a few memories for you as you leave today. And thanks again for attending.